Hello, welcome to the Freedom From Error podcast. I'm joined today with Farzan Mazanani. He is an award-winning author, dedicated joy fitness transformation coach, a mentor, certified emotion code practitioner, and certified belief clearing practitioner, and the creator of a modality called Joyful Fix Quantum Healing. His book is called Joyful Fix, How to Break Free from Stagnation and Move Forward in Life. Thank you for joining me, Farzan.
Thank you for having me on. I'm really looking forward to our conversation today.
Oh, yeah. I appreciate you reaching out and offering to be on my little podcast. Hopefully, we get out there and help a few people. We briefly chatted about some topics, and probably my first question is, could you tell us a little bit about your joyful quantum healing?
Sure. So I'm the firm believer that the healing process shouldn't be painful, because we all think that we have to go and explore all the pains and bring them up and live them again and go through those painful process to be able to heal from whatever we are dealing with. But there can be an easier way, which is not that painful. And I've been focusing on that for a past while and found some breakthroughs to help people to just go through the process and to be able to heal themselves. There are some sides on it. So one of the things is that we have to elevate our consciousness to be able to go through that process. And when we see things with a different lens, with a different view, then everything changes. You know, if you believe that life is harsh, life is there to just get me, and I have to protect myself all the time, I have to be on my toes, and everything is going to hurt me or something like that. That definitely happens like that. But if you conclude that life is my friend and whatever that is happening is for my growth, is teaching me something. And when you have that perspective, then you start seeing differently. Your experience is going to be different. And even if something harsh happens, you know that it is for your benefit. And we often have seen that in our life. You know, all of us have had some moments in the past that we were regretful at the time, painful, going through a lot of stuff. At the time, we were not happy and we were not appreciating whatever that was happening. But after maybe a couple of years, looking back in that moment, we see the benefit that we have gained through those experiences. So instead of waiting a couple of years, we can change our view and see the life differently now, instead of going through all that pain. And pain is relative. You know, when we are in the gym, for example, I go to the gym and I start lifting those weights and stuff. But if I'm not ready for that, I'm just going to give up. I say that I don't like this pain. But for a bodybuilder or an athlete who is preparing themselves for competing in Olympics, if they don't feel the pain during the workout, it means that they did nothing. They didn't do anything. It means that it wasn't good. So they are looking forward to that receiving, getting that pain, you know, during the workout, because they know that pain is going to build them. So it's all relative, all the pain and all the experiences that we have, based on our view, can be changed to a joyful experience instead of painful experience.
Yeah, you brought up a lot of good topics there, and really reminds me of the quote from Wayne Dyer: when you change the way you look at things, the things you look at change. And
Exactly.
it is, everything is relative, and our view, if we're looking at things through a negative lens, we're going to have usually negative outcomes, negative consequences. And just that little bit of restructuring how we view things, we talk a lot about, positive and negative self-talk. I'm big on focusing on the words that we use to talk to ourselves and to other people. Because usually, if we can just change a word or two in a sentence, it goes from negative to positive. And if we can remove some things, a lot of those absolutes from our vocabulary, must, should, and always, never, just little things like that Dr. Albert Ellis talked a great deal about. And just view things as in, things are not happening to me, they're happening for me. So
Exactly.
I can learn from them, whether they be positive or negative. And having that unrealistic expectation that I can go through life and not have any pain is kind of a fairy tale. And you're gonna have ups, you're gonna have downs.
Yeah, it's all about the levels of consciousness. We all start from the bottom. What is the bottom? Bottom is victim consciousness. So we point fingers. Whatever happens, somebody else is at fault. I find fault with others and things, and I blame them for not being successful, not going through some misery and those kind of things. So we all start from there. And it is a daily practice that we do. We find something to blame our problems and put all problems on somebody else and stuff like that. So it is a daily practice that we do. But that is the level of consciousness that is the baseline for everybody, the default that we have. But how can we elevate that? I was thinking about that and I went through the process of receiving some information that I just want to share with you. Different levels that we can go up from that baseline. So the next level after the baseline is saying, I am who I am. That is an important recognition because sometimes we go through those processes of guilt and shame and those kind of things, and they bring us down. And it is not helpful to just deal with those. And so when we say I am who I am, we are accepting ourselves, whatever we are not rejecting ourselves. We are not fighting with who we are. And so that acceptance is very important and it starts from ourselves. And then we can expand it from ourselves outside. So the next level is saying it is what it is. So from I am, what who I am, we go to it is what it is. It means that whatever that is outside, I'm not going to be able to fight and change and remove and those kind of things. If I be able to accept what it is that is outside, it is a very good state of being. We are in the state of contentment instead of frustration and rejection and those kind of things. We are accepting whatever that is outside. So that is the next stage. But there is some more stages after that. I'm just gonna go to just one of them for this topic that we have. So the next level is called I am what it is. So if we combine the first two, from I am who I am to it is what it is, we get I am what it is. It means taking full responsibility for whatever that is happening to me, And what is the significance of full responsibility is full responsibility means full power. Because if I be 99% responsible for something, it means that then that 1% can come back and bite me in the back, and I don't have any control on it because it is in somebody else's hand. But if I be fully responsible for something, it means that I have full control to change it, to keep it. I can choose to keep it or change it. So if we go to that stage that we take 100% responsibility for things that are not even related to me, it means that I have the say to change it. I have the power to change it. That is very important. And usually, where anger comes to play is that there are some circumstances that we cannot change, and we just start fighting with those situations and stuff, and it comes as an anger because it's a tension, you know. And it is very crucial to go through those stages from victim consciousness to I am who I am, and then elevate us to it is what it is. So it is inside out. You start from inside, spread it outside. So inside out process. And then when you say, I am what it is outside in process. So you reflect whatever that is outside, bring it back inside. So it's two process. One is inside out and the other one is outside in. And then when you see the life like that, life becomes a mirror that reflects you. It means that whatever you see that is not pleasant, it means that there is something inside you that interpreting that thing as unpleasant. So, and then you full respond, you take full responsibility and you can change it. It's a straightforward process. But we have to. So sometimes we say that I have those qualities, I have those attributes, those behaviors, and I don't have any control over them. So there are some attributes like being gloomy and sad and depressed and those kind of things, and or be anxious and dealing with anxiety and stress, or even fear or guilt and those kind of things. So we have to recognize that we all carry those energies. So there is something called trapped emotions. And a lot of people are not familiar with this topic. So I just want to open it up just a little bit. Maybe it can help us during this process. So trapped emotions are the emotions that are stored in our body. And how do they get stuck? Is that, for example, I'm driving back home from work and somebody cut me off in the traffic. And I get mad, start swearing, I don't have a very good feeling, and I get mad. And that anger is an energy, and I'm tired at the time. So my subconscious mind tells that I'm not going to deal with that for now. I'm going to store it somewhere in the body. So it might be stored in our liver, for example. So anger has a tendency to go to the liver, but it might be stored somewhere else too. So it gets stored in there, and then it disrupts the function of that organ, and it has a lower energy, lower than our average energy that we have in our body. So it brings us down. And what happens is that we carry that energy for a lifetime until it is released. But it doesn't get released by itself. We carry that energy. So how many of those energies we carry in our body? On average, every person carries between 200 to 300 of those type of energies, the emotions in their body. And it is not easy. And as we get older, we gather more of those. For example, I have the anger in my body, that energy in my body. What happens is that when the situation becomes available again, because I have that vibration of anger within me, I snap again and I receive another anger somewhere else in my body gets stuck. And then I gather all those. Is like carrying a backpack full of stone or something like that. It's a load on our shoulder. That's why, as we get older, we are not that agile and fresh anymore because the load is getting heavier and heavier. You know, for recovery, for joyfulness, whatever you call it, as we get older, it gets harder and harder. So we are carrying those energies. And I'm carrying those energies. Other people are carrying their own energies as well. So when I look at myself from that perspective, I can be more compassionate towards myself. I know that if I'm behaving a certain way, maybe it's because of those energies that I'm carrying. You know, I develop more understanding behavior towards myself. And that is the meaning of self-love and self-understanding and self-compassion. You know, I don't blame myself. I know those energies are acting out. And then the same thing happens for others as well. So I see others the way they are, and instead of starting to judge people, I know that whatever they are behaving is based on the energies that they are carrying. And sometimes, most of the times, they are not even aware what they are carrying. But they just behave like that because of those energies. So I develop my more understanding towards others as well. That is where the forgiveness comes to play. I can forgive myself. I can forgive others because I know that a lot of times we are behaving a certain way because of those circumstances. So my emotion is not me. It means that if I change my emotion, I don't become a different person. You know, so one time I'm mad, one time I'm sad, one time I'm happy. I don't change personalities. I'm the same person looking at those things. So those are just the stains on my clothing, a layer. It's just a layer, the emotional layer. I call it the emotional layer. We have other layers as well. We have the physical layer. I'm not my physical body because my cells regenerate. My cells in my body goes out all the time. And so the skin cells renew after maybe a month and a half. They are not the same skin anymore. All the cells are new ones. The old ones are gone. In the flesh, it takes maybe 2 months, 3 months. In the bones, it might take a little bit more, 4 months. But after 6 months, all the cells in my body is changed. So if I'm just my physical body, then I have to be a different person. But I'm looking at my body and I'm observing it. Who is observing it? It's something else than the body. So I'm not my body. I'm not my emotions. I'm not my thought. If I be my thought, what happens if I don't think about anything? I still exist. So I'm a consciousness that is beyond all those. And for the emotions, when I know that those emotional charges are affecting my life, it's just like a stain in my clothing, on my clothing. So it can be washed. But the thing is that we cannot sometimes separate ourselves from those problems. We think that we are those problems, but we are not. We are something beyond all those and have the capability to just change them. I know this topic might be a little bit heavy for people, but that realization that we can be friend with ourselves, with others, with life, it is a big shift in consciousness, in our perspective. So that's what I've been working on in the past few years and have seen dominant changes in people. Sometimes I just explain those kind of things, and sometimes I go ahead and clean up those baggages that they have. It's emotional baggage, it's mental baggage. Those energies are accessible through the subconscious mind, so we can go and zap them out and clean them. It is possible, and then the big shift comes.
Yeah, you hit on a lot of key words that, I wish I had a nickel for every time I said the word acceptance, because and contentment, those are huge, when it comes to trying to live a healthy life, is we feel that we have to be in control of everything, when in reality, the only thing we're in control of is ourselves, our thoughts. We can't control other people. We carry around all kinds of baggage from the past that we don't forgive other people. We tend to hold people up to a higher standard than we hold ourselves, and we don't allow them to be human and flawed because we all make mistakes. We don't show them, that grace, that forgiveness. And three of the main things that I've talked about for years is I don't care if it's alcohol and drug treatment, or if you're taking anger management, or whatever class you can think of, is number one, love yourself, and number two, forgive yourself, and number three, forgive others. Because if you can do those three things, then I think you're off to a good start. Because that's if you don't love yourself, you're not going to be open. If you don't forgive yourself, you're just going to carry around all that baggage. And if you don't forgive others, then it's even more baggage you're going to be carrying around. And what I try to tell people is, if something that happened 20 years ago is impacting you today, then it didn't happen 20 years ago. It's happening today. You're putting stress on your body. You're still carrying it around. And odds are, I told this to one individual, and he got a little upset with me. He's like, "You're telling me I got to forgive so and so for doing such and such back when?" I said, "Yeah, that's if you're going to try to move forward in life, you have to just forgive people and just let that baggage go." And they're just like, "Well, I just can't do that." I said, "Well, then you're not going to move forward, because I guarantee you that person that you're angry at sleeps just fine at night, probably doesn't even remember doing you wrong. But you're the one today living with it every single day. They've moved forward, you haven't. So who's winning?"
Exactly. Sometimes there are some circumstances in life that we have that choice, and if we don't take the right choice, we have to bear the circumstances of that choice. If you know something is helping you for your benefit, and you still stick to that old dogma, what happens? You're going to suffer, And a lot of beliefs that we have are like that. So that's why I always talk about the usefulness, the practicality. If something is useful, just take it. And if it's there is something that is not useful, there is not for your benefit, just leave it. But sometimes we get stuck in there because we were told from childhood that this is good and that is bad. We get stuck in those loops. But sometimes we have to question things again and again and develop an open mind to see what is really working, what is helpful for me. If it's not helpful, what is the necessity to just keep it? We can drop it. We have that choice. When we have that awareness, that is the time that we have the choice. If somebody choose to get the stock, and he knows that there are some other options. That is their choice. They're gonna suffer. Suffering is an illusion. To me, is suffering is an illusion. Pain might be real. I can feel the pain, but suffering is different. Suffering is in our mind. You know, as I said before, it all depends on our interpretation of that pain. So we can develop that view that see a pain as something that is helping me. But if I choose to suffer, that is a different story. And we all have that choice to act on the things, or we can leave it. And a lot of times it all depends on the subconscious programming as well. The subconscious is a very interesting topic. You know, they say that when you think about something, then option.
Yeah, my internet just did a long pause there, so I totally lost that when you're talking about the unconscious, and it's still doing it. Well, shoot. Yeah, my internet has its days. Most days it works just fine, but anytime I try to do anything, that's when it wants to start acting up. Okay. But anyway, like I said, I'll go back and edit all that. Try to remember what I was going to say there.
Yeah, I was talking about the subconscious mind and how it affects our life. It is based on the measurements that they've had on the mind. It did it again, I
Darn
guess.
thing. Yeah, I don't know why it's acting that way. Did just fine for like 30 something minutes. Anyway, hopefully it'll. All right. Well, we'll keep trying, but I know for me, I've worked with incarcerated individuals for several years. And they can be a little bit stubborn when it comes to when you challenge their views on things and their values. But if we don't pose those questions to them, and the question I usually bring up is, how's that working for you? Well, I'm mad about this, this, and this. Okay, well, how's that working for you? You know, what's your current situation? Okay, what are some other choices, some other options? Because obviously this ain't working for you. You know, ultimately, you know, we're trying to get through life and get what we want. But like you said, if we turn that power over to other people and allow them to dictate our reactions to certain things, then you know, we definitely don't have any control. We're handing that over to other people. Well, they made me mad and I punched them in the face and I went to jail. Okay, well, they made me mad. They made me do this. You know, it's that not, you know, taking responsibility and, The whole victim mentality. Unfortunately, see it quite a bit, and that is just, it seems to me that it's just, we're creatures of habit, and we like what's normal and comfortable to us, and we get wrapped up in that victim mentality, and we hold on to it for dear life, because that's our identity. We're the victim. And I try to tell people, if you view yourself as a victim, then that's exactly what's going to happen. Somebody is going to victimize you. If you choose not to view yourself as a victim, then good luck. They might try, but they won't succeed.
Yeah, and sometimes we do things. So subconscious mind is like a train that is going north, and we are in that train, and we decide to go south. But who is stronger? Of course, the train is stronger. So it is taking us north, whether either we want it or not, we are not moving north, even if we are moving south in the train. So sometimes life is like that. We decide to do something and then we don't feel that power. We are powerless because of the programming that we have in our subconscious mind. So that's why I believe all the major changes should start from there, from deeper inside. And then when we have that conscious and subconscious aligned, that is the best way to move forward. Because if they're not aligned, who is going to win? We don't have the power to fight that battle and win that battle. It is not within our power. Subconscious mind is going to dictate whatever your direction that we are going to go. So that is important. And how can we get access to those informations? So by monitoring ourselves, our self-talk and behavior, and watching it closely, it comes to the surface. As you said, the way we talk is important. The self-talk is very important. Those are the programmings that we have. And when we notice the way that we are behaving, automatic behavior is from subconscious mind. So when you are reacting automatically to something, it is coming from inside. That automatic reaction is the attribute of the subconscious mind. It is like digestion. It's like breathing. They are automatic. We don't do anything for those. They just happen, you know? Our behavior, when they are automatic, it's coming from subconscious mind. So we can notice those automatic behaviors. We can notice those self-talks. We can write them down, get familiar with those. And then when we are noticing them, it means that we are turning a light in a dark room. They disappear. When you have a dark room, as soon as you turn the light on, all the darkness is gone. The darkness is lack of light. So if we just go through the process of just watching those kind of things that is happening within us, the automatic reaction, the self-talk, and those kind of things, it's like shedding light to those, and they start to change and disappear. So that is one practical way that everybody can do. There are some other ways to get help from people who can connect to the source of those problems from the subconscious level and clean them up. But we might have access to go kind of things or not. But the things that we can do is just looking at ourselves from the higher level, from the top, to see what's happening within us.
All right. Well, I think that's a Good area to stop on. Thank you so much for being on, Farzin. And so, if somebody wanted to reach out to you, do you have a website? Is there social media? I know your book's available on Amazon, so be sure to check that out. I'll try to put a link in the description.
Yeah, actually, my website is joyfulfix.com. That is the title of the book as well, Joyful Fix. So if people go to that website in the contact page, I have a page that people can record their voice in there. And when they record their voice, I receive that, and then we can set up a free consultation. And in that free consultation, I go through the steps they can just go through to improve their life. There are some detoxification that can happen, clean up from physical, emotional, and mental layers that I talked about before on an energetic and subconscious level. So those kind of services are available. And when we do those cleanup, what happens is that your mind has two parts, the left brain and right brain. They can communicate better with each other and then become whole. And then you bring that energy into heart. There are a lot of blockages in our heart usually that doesn't let us to communicate with ourselves and with life and with others. Those can be removed. And then you bring it down to your stomach, the gut area, and clean those energies, and then you are aligned. You're like that person who is in the train moving north, and the train is moving north as well. So everything is aligned. And then you can have those kind of inspirations and inspired action, and you can act on the things that comes to you, because all of us are one idea away from being a, let's say, billionaire. All those people who have created something substantial, it started from an idea. They had an idea that they implemented on that, acted on it, and they started something huge. And we are all one idea ahead, away from being in that stage. But it has to come from a vessel that is clean. That cleanup is necessary part. So what I do for people sometimes, I help them to go through that cleanup process on the subconscious level so they can have a better life, a joyful life. Being more happy and joyful is the ultimate goal. And the next step after that is being impactful. So life that is fulfilled has two elements. One is joy and the other one is impact. So if we combine joy and impact, we create a fulfilled life, you know? And it is possible. Some people might think, no, it's not possible. But I have worked on a lot of people. Big shifts, big changes happen when you work on those cleanups on the subconscious level. It is like a miracle. And I see that every morning, every day, every time when I work on somebody and I see the results, that is the satisfaction I get, you know? When I see changes in people, shifts in people, they shift from the bottom, the baseline, to someone who can enjoy life, who can have more impact. So, if somebody needs a consultation, a free consultation, all you can do is go to joyfulfix.com contact page and leave me a message. You can write it down or you can just record your voice in there. And then you get your session and we talk about it, more details in the process. It is a joyful process, I promise. It's not painful.
Well, all right. Yeah, make sure to check out his book, go to his website, look around, and if you need a consultation, please reach out to him And thank you so much for coming on. And I think we put out a lot of good information. Hopefully it helps some people along the way and they can live their best lives and move forward and stop spinning their wheels.
Yeah, thank you very much for inviting me.
No problem.